Across the United States of America, from New York to California and back glazed again, for many months of the year there streams and sings for its heady supper a dazed and prejudiced procession of European lecturers. Scholars, sociologists, economists, writers, authorities on this and that, and even in theory on the United States of America. And breathlessly between addresses and receptions, in planes and trains and boiling hotel bedroom ovens, many of them attempt to keep journals and diaries. At first, confused and shocked by shameless profusion and almost shamed by generosity, unaccustomed to such importance as they are assumed by their hosts to possess, and up against the barrier of a common language, they write in their notebooks like demons generalizing away on character and culture and the American political scene. But towards the middle of their middle-aged whisk through Middle Western clubs and universities, the fury of the writing flags. Their spirits are lowered by the spirit with which they are everywhere strongly greeted, and which, in ever-increasing doses, they themselves lower. And they begin to mistrust themselves and their apparent popularity, for they have found too often that an audience will receive a Lenten lecture on, say, ceramics with the same uninhibited enthusiasm that it accorded the very week before to a paper on the modern Turkish novel. And in their diaries, more and more do such entries appear as no way of escape, or buffalo, or I am beaten. Until at last they cannot write a word, and twittering all over, old before their time, with eyes like rissoles in the sand, they are helped up the gangway of the homebound liner by kind bosom friends of all kinds and bosoms, who boister them on the back, pick them up again, thrust bottles, sonnets, cigars, addresses into their pockets, have a farewell party in the cabin, pick them up again, and snickering and yelping are gone to wait at the dockside for another boat from Europe and another batch of fresh, crisp, green lecturers. There they go every spring from New York to Los Angeles, exhibitionists, polemicists, histrionic publicists, theological rhetoricians, historical hoddy-doddies, ballotamines, ulterior decorators, max-factored actors, windbags and bigwigs and humbugs, men in love with stamps, men in love with steaks, men after millionaires' widows, men with elephantiasis of the reputation, huge trunks and teeny minds, authorities on gas, bishops, bestsellers, new spellers, editors looking for writers, writers looking for publishers, publishers looking for dollars, existentialists, serious physicists with nuclear missions, men from the BBC who speak as though they had the Elgin marbles in their mouths. Hot-boiling philosophers, professional Irishmen, very leprechaun-y, and, I'm afraid, fat poets with slim volumes. And see, too, in that linguacious stream, the tall, monocled men smelling of saddle soap and club armchairs, their breath a nice blending of whiskey and fox's blood, with big, protruding upper-class tusks and county moustaches, presumably invented in England and sent abroad to advertise punch. Who, to one's surprise, one finds are here to lecture to women's clubs on some such unlikely subject as the history of etching in the Shetland Islands. And also the brassy, bossy men women with corrugated iron perms and hippo hides who come self-announced as ordinary British housewives to talk to rich, minked chunks of American matronhood about the iniquity of the English health service, the criminal sloth of the miners, the visible tail and horns of Mr. Aneurin Bevan, and the fear of everyone in England to go out alone at night because of the organized legions of cosh boys against whom the police are powerless, owing to the refusal of those in power to equip them with revolvers and to flog to ribbon every adolescent offender on any charge at all. And their shiver and teeter also, meek and driven, their little eyes lost and rabbit scared behind big glasses steamed over by the smoke of countless cocktail parties, those British authors, unfortunate enough to have written, after years of unadventurous forgotten work, one bad novel which became enormously popular on both sides of the Atlantic. At home, when success first hit them, they were mildly delighted. A couple of literary luncheons went sugar tipsy to their heads, like the washing sherry served before those luncheons. And perhaps, as the lovely money rolled lushly in, they began to dream in their moony writer's way of being able to retire to the country, keep wasps, or was it bees, and never write another lousy word. But in come the literary agent's trigger men and the publisher's armed narcs. You must go to the States and make a personal appearance. Your novel is killing them over there, and we're not surprised either. You must go around the States lecturing to women and the inoffensive writers who've never dared lecture anyone, let alone women. They are frightened of women. They do not understand women. They write about women as creatures that never existed, and the women lap it up. These novelists cry out, "But what shall we lecture about? The English novel. I don't read novels. Great women in fiction. I don't like fiction or women." But off they're wafted first class in the plush bowels of the Queen Victoria with a list of engagements long as a New York menu or half an hour with a book by Charles Morgan. And soon they're losing their little cold as goldfish paws in the great general glutinous handshake of a clutch of enveloping hostesses. Ernest Raymond, the author of Tell England, who once made a journey around the American women's clubs, being housed and entertained at each small town he stopped at by the richest and largest and furriest lady available. On one occasion, he stopped at some little station and was met, as usual, by an enormous motor car full of a large horn-rimmed businessman, looking exactly like a large horn-rimmed businessman on the films, and his roly-poly-pearly wife. Mr. Raymond sat with her in the back of the car, and off they went, the husband driving. At once, she began to say how utterly delighted she and her husband of the committee were to have him at their Women's Literary and Social Guild, and to compliment him on his books. "I don't think I've ever in all my life enjoyed a book so much as Sorrel and Son," she said. "What you don't know about human nature. I think Sorrel is one of the most beautiful characters ever portrayed." Ernest Raymond let her talk on while he stared, embarrassed, in front of him. All he could see were the three double chins that her husband wore at the back of his neck. On and on, she gushed in praise of Sorrel and Son until he just had to say, "I quite agree with you," he said. "A beautiful book indeed, but I'm afraid I didn't write Sorrel and Son. It was written by an old friend of mine, Mr. Warwick Deeping." And the large, horn-rimmed, double-chinned husband at the wheel said without turning, "Caught again, Emily." See the garrulous others also, gabbing and garlanded from one nest of culture vultures to another, people selling the English way of life and condemning the American way as they swig and guzzle through it. People resurrecting the theories of surrealism for the benefits of remote parochial female audiences who did not know it was dead, not having known it had ever been alive. People talking about Etruscan pots and pans, to a bunch of dead pans and wealthy pots near Boston. And there, too, in the sticky thick of lecturers moving across the continent, go the foreign poets, guttural troubadours, lyrical one-night standers, dollar-mad nightingales, remittance bards from at home, myself among them, booming with the worst.